Aloha class, last time I talked to you about neurons, and this time I'm going to talk to you about signal propagation. One of the ways that early physiologists studied signal propagation in neurons is by way of the giant axons in the squid. They have these enormous giant axons. Invertebrates have unmyelinated axons, so they tend to be really fat in diameter. So when you extract an axon, you can put electrodes on it, and if you stimulate it, you can record what happens. And what you'll see is a response. This is, of course, a graded response because over time it decays. So this graded response is decay with time or distance. What determines the distance that the signal is actually propagated? Well, it's proportional to resistances. Now, you know, you might get afraid with these terminologies like resistance, but just think of anything that flows like water through a hose. If you have a hose with a bunch of holes in the outside in the membrane, that would have weak membrane resistance, and of course, the flow would leak out all over the place and it wouldn't travel very far, right? So it's proportional to how strong the membrane resistance is. Similarly, what is internal resistance? Well, it's resistance to flow. So if you had a hose that was full of pebbles, that would block the flow, right? And so you want internal resistance to be low. You want the fluid to flow. So you want the electricity to flow, you're going to want to decrease internal resistance. Increase membrane resistance and decrease internal resistance. Okay. Now, of course, if you go above threshold, you'll get an action potential, and those voltage-gated channels will open, which will then cause another change in the membrane potential and cause the action potential to travel. Action potentials are different than graded potentials because they're active and they don't decrease in magnitude. They remain constant. So why are they directional? Well, because of that absolute refractory period. Once that membrane potential is used up, it needs time to rebuild those chemical gradients across the membrane. So how do you increase that internal conduction velocity of an action potential? Well, it's the same thing. You have to increase the distance that's traveled by the electrotonic potential. So you can decrease internal resistance or increase the membrane resistance. So if you do that, then with each action potential, it'll travel farther before it starts another action potential. Okay, so that's our hypothesis, that we can increase conduction velocity by decreasing internal resistance and or increasing the membrane resistance. And we can address this hypothesis using the comparative method. So you can see that if you look at either myelinated fibers or So myelinated fibers, of course, increase the external resistance. And myelinated fibers are much faster conducting than non-myelinated fibers. However, if you look within myelinated or within unmyelinated fibers, the ones that have fatter diameters have faster conduction velocities. So larger diameters decrease the internal resistance and they're faster. Myelinated increases the external resistance, the membrane resistance, and they're faster. Okay, so we can decrease the internal resistance by increasing the axon diameter. Okay, so you make it fatter, it's easier for the electric signal to travel. You can also accomplish increased conduction velocity by increasing external resistance. And, of course, the famous example is myelin. Myelin is electrically neutral. So it's like wrapping your electrical wires with tape or something like that. Okay, so it increases the membrane resistance by adding insulation. And recently there was an article, well, in 2004, and they showed this really cool thing about Schwann cell function. So they form from adhesive patches between the outer surface of the myelin sheath and the Schwann cell plasma membrane, and it makes these Kajal bands. And if it didn't have those Kajal bands, those cells will elongate too slowly and result in really short internodes, and that impairs impulse conduction. So that tells you something about the way that the neurons function as well, and that those internodes have to be at an optimal distance in order to maximize conduction. Okay, so we can increase membrane resistance by adding insulation, and that makes the whole thing go faster. So if we wrap our axons with Schwann cells creating this myelin sheath, then what happens is it increases the membrane resistance and it causes that action potential to travel farther before it gets to a patch of naked membrane where it can then initiate another action potential. Okay, so with each action potential, it's actually traveling a little farther. This is called saltatory conduction because it goes in jumps. So it's basically jumping down the axon and, you know, reinitializing at these internodes. So we're just talking about signal conduction along these axons. And of course, neurons with really, really long axons are usually the sensory neurons going from the sensory receptors to the central nervous system, and then the motor neurons going from the central nervous system back to the motor outputs. And so just wanted to point out again this interaction between, or this chain of neurons that use graded potentials and all or none potentials. And these graded potentials are really useful for integrating, gathering information. All action potentials are useful for transmitting information. And then there's a lot of, so the central nervous system is composed of a lot of different kinds of axons, some with very, very long nerve fibers or axons, and some that are very short and have lots of connections. Those are really important in gathering, integrating, processing information. Okay, in the lab this week, you're going to look at compound action potentials. So if you think about a visible nerve fiber, it's actually a bundle of a whole bunch of fibers. There's a lot of fibers in a visible nerve fiber. So what you're going to observe is a compound action potential, and it's the sum of a number of different nerve fibers. So there's fast fibers, average fibers, and slow fibers. They're all generating action potentials. And what you will observe electrically is the sum of all of those. That's what a compound action potential is. So it has a little bit of a broader shape than an isolated single action potential because it's the sum of many potentials. Okay, and they vary a bit in speed because nerve bundles are composed of fibers of many different diameters. So what you're going to do is you're going to stimulate the nerve. You're going to isolate a big nerve, and then you're going to stimulate it. And of course, the first thing you're going to see is this artifact of the stimulus, okay? And then what you'll see is you'll eventually start to see a response, which is the compound action potential. Okay, so you can measure a bunch of different things like latency of the peak of the cap, the peak amplitude of the cap, and then the duration of the cap. Okay, and then you can also decrease the stimulus intensity and then find the voltage at which you can just barely detect the cap. Okay, and that will be the threshold stimulus. So have fun. It'll be a really cool lab.